All right. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm Sakshi Soi. I am an educator with experience in project management. I have with me Major General Sanjay Soi, who will be our moderator for the day. He's a father to two girls and actively engaged with various groups working towards the cause. It's been a rough last couple of days for, you know, due to the lockdown, but we just need to ride it out together. All right, so we are here to discuss the safety concerns that a lot of women and young girls face, specifically in light of the, you know, the latest incident, the boys' locker room group chat you must have heard about. To discuss that, we have two guests on our panel. Our first panelist is Lieutenant Colonel Rohit Mishra. He's an ex-army officer, a father of two girls, and the founder of Mission Fight Back. Colonel Mishra served the army for nearly 22 years. He served in the Jammu and Kashmir. He has been part of the counter-terrorist attack team and also served the UN peacekeeping forces. He founded Mission Fight Back in 2018 to empower women with survival tactics, to escape predators on the street, and to help them build and work on their instinct to identify a dangerous situation. Mission Fight Back focuses on building all the three parameters. One is your mental strength, second is the physical tactics, and finally the technology aspect, which Colonel Mishra will be sharing with us today. Thank you so much, Colonel. It's an honor to have you here with us on the discussion. Our second panelist is Mrs. Nisha Dua. She's a cyber safety and wellness coach at Cyber Peace Foundation. Mrs. Dua comes with extensive experience in cyber safety, working closely with children on educating them about the internet world. She collaborates with multiple agencies like the government, school boards, tech organizations to promote the cause. Welcome, ma'am. It's a pleasure to have you here with us today for the discussion.
Thank you for having me here, Sakshi, for this very important topic.
Now, without wasting any time, we'll quickly dive into the session for today. Last 1 week, we have spoken to several men and women from different age groups, specifically focusing on parents, about the biggest concerns that they have with respect to the safety of their children. Whether it's a girl child or a boy child, it does not matter what gender, but generally safety of children keeping in mind, and in light of the recent incident that I spoke about, which is the boys' locker room group chat. This specific incident has led to parents scrambling for answers and solutions on how they can empower their kids and how they can empower themselves to survive the dangers of such mentality. Why is it okay to violently objectify women and underage girls? Colonel Rohit, my first question would be to you, how deep do you think is this issue of thinking that it's okay to glorify atrocities against women, that it's okay to violently objectify women and underage girls? All right.
Rohit has gone offline. He's joining in. Let's see.
Yeah, just got him back. Colonel Mishra, can you hear us? Technology.
Yeah.
All right.
Rohit, can you hear?
I can hear you, sir. Thank you.
Yes, actually, you can repeat the question now.
Okay. So we have a first question about how deep do you think this mentality or the psyche runs, right? That it's okay to violently objectify women and underage girls. That it's okay to think or glorify atrocities against women.
The first thing that needs to understand is we can get into the psychology of things and we can try to get into the semantics of things, but that is not what is required here. What you mentioned about the boys' locker room, we need to understand why does it happen. Boys have traditionally been separating women, you know, from her individual being to her body parts or a body. So when they see a woman, they do not see an entire being. They see a body, you know, and the moment there is body, there are going to be sexual desires. And the easiest thing for men is to, you know, start blaming the hormones, or I was just reading somewhere that, you know, people have started victimizing the victim. Why is she wearing a certain kind of clothes? Why is she wearing this thing? And she's kind of inviting things on herself. See, so like I said before, getting into the psychology of the whole thing, we need to understand why is this happening. And this is basically happening because this is what is starting at home. This is probably what they're seeing at home. And they think it is okay to objectify women and see them only as sexual objects. See them, you know, as girls. You know, like out of 10 girls, there'll be probably just two of them who would be their targets. Maybe because of the certain way they're wearing their clothes.
I think we lost his audio again.
Maybe.
Let's give it a minute. But definitely we have our audience today mentioning how this is a very relevant discussion in today's time. And with lockdown, it's been noticed. There have been a lot of data points that have identified that general you know, mentality or thinking towards viewing of porn, for example, or consuming child porn has gone up drastically. And it's very disturbing, like generally the trends that have been coming out.
Yeah, I know. The problem is actually very deep-rooted, and we need to think in a long term, short term as well as long term, whether it is a psyche of the boys need to be changed. And the other thing is, if you look at Nisha, I would, till Rohit comes, I'll just ask you that basically, if you see from the web space perspective, you notice that the reach of internet has increased manifold. At the same time, number of social applications are also available. It has given rise to a new set of challenges for women's safety. Yeah. Could you just share with us a little more about the dangers that lurk the web?
Okay. Thank you for giving this opportunity. So, internet is full of possibilities and opportunities, and which we are seeing especially in the times of COVID-19 pandemic, when around 3 billion people are actually locked up at home. And out of them, 1.8 billion are children. I mean, it's a very unnormal and a unique situation. And what is keeping us going, what is keeping us sane is technology. It is internet, it is cell phones. And because of that, we are connected with our friends, we are connected with our families, and we are able to make use of the services and pull along with our day-to-day life. So internet has become a bridge currently between the lockdown family and the world. No wonder the internet usage has surged hugely globally across the globe. And in India, the recent reports suggest that in past 4 weeks, the social media usage has gone up as high as 87%. Children are also using internet a lot because schools are closed. So virtual learning is the online, the new norm now. Playgrounds are banned, so they have to play games online. They cannot go and interact with friends, so they use social media platforms for chatting. So kids are also a lot on the internet. Okay, now you imagine a situation where billions of adults with all kinds of intent, good, bad, malicious, they are on the internet, along with the young, vulnerable children who are there on the internet to finish a project, to finish an assignment for the teacher gave, or to enhance their learning, or to just have some fun. And some of these adults are online predators who are actually looking for victims online. And our children are vulnerable and easy prey for them. So what they do, they befriend the children. They adopt fake identity, which a child would love. They identify, okay, this is a child. I'm going to now, this is my new victim. And they assume the identity which that small person, small child would identify with, would like to. Okay, it's not difficult to post any, you know, to put up any picture, because who knows what who's behind the laptop. It may be a monkey sitting behind the laptop having a photo of a stock actor. Okay, so they assume that fake identity. They go to the chat rooms frequented by the children and they make friends with them. They would have already done some background work on these kids. They're very methodical. And slowly, a bond starts developing. The trust deepens. They gain confidence. They start sharing personal details. From personal details, they go on to the pictures. From pictures, they go on to pictures, maybe, you know, in certain poses. So, you know, all that is happening. And at a time, maybe the child realizes, I don't think I want to post this kind of a picture to this person. And the child wants to back out. But the child cannot. Why? Because they already have his previous pictures to blackmail him or her. And they also have his personal details. And many a times, they actually threaten the children. I'll harm your younger brother, sister. I'll harm your parents. You'll kill so-and-so. And you know, 6-year-old, 10-year-old, 12-year-old, 16-year-old, the kids are scared. And they give in. There are very few of them who have the courage, or whose parents or teachers would have spotted that something is going wrong. They are lucky to get out of it at the right time, but a lot of them don't. And they fall prey to these predators who start to sexually exploit.
I think
Nisha has gone through. I think where she left, so I'll take Rohit there, that then the kind of problem, the kind of impersonation they do, and then they get hold of the children and play with their psyche, play with their mind, and ultimately, then how do you see Rohit, that this thing converting into from virtual into physical?
The moment a child gets entangled into any kind of situation wherein a person is impersonating as somebody else, and the child is entangled wherein a certain probably nudes have been shared or sexting has been done. These, like what Nisha was mentioning, is what leads to blackmail. Now, there are cases where men actually join marital sites like jeevansathi.com, shadi.com. They could be married men. That is one. Now, you have so many dating apps like Tinder, Bumble, Tantan, and there's so many other dating apps. Now, these men, what they do is, they actually use the DPs or the profile picture of somebody else. So, The idea is, see, the first thing why a woman or why a man is going on a dating site is because it is always the physicality of the being. You know, they see a good-looking a boy or a good-looking girl, and they go, left swipe, right swipe. And what in case if the girl has actually done a right swipe and she started talking to a boy whom she thinks looks a certain way, and but actually on the ground, maybe the person is somebody else. And now she starts talking to this guy. And now he is making certain excuses of not meeting her. Certain chats have happened. And at some point of time when there is going to be a physical meet or a physical date which is going to be there, this man turns up. Now she knows that this is not the person she has been talking to, because she was actually under the impression that she's talking to somebody else. And this is the place where where the violence starts. This is the place where the blackmail starts. And now the girl, actually she is so vulnerable because now she cannot turn back. And she cannot go back because she knows she's going to be blackmailed, because there are certain pictures which have got shared. What these people do not understand is when a woman is sharing her pictures, right? It is also based on a lot of trust. So the first thing that, of course, gets broken is the trust. And now, just because certain pictures have been shared or certain messages have been shared, and now since the threat is about sharing these probably online or probably sharing it with her family, so the woman or the girl actually gives into this kind of a blackmail. I think Nisha is back. She can further add on to it. I was just filling up for you right now.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, what you said is that probably it's so dangerous that the person who has been impersonated, like somebody impersonated me, he would not even know that somebody is impersonating as me, and but somebody known to me might have been blackmailed and would have been forced to share the information, forced to share the data. But yes, so Nisha, we were just talking to him. So has this all led to increase in cyber crime?
Absolutely. Like I was telling earlier, the crimes, sexual exploitation crimes against the girls has, even minor boys, has really increased by these online predators. And this is, I'm talking in context of the current situation when we have so many users, and then even the children's online time is not getting as monitored, as controlled by the parents as it was earlier because of the current, you know, situation. And Sakshi had asked about the online risk. The other online risk, if I may add, is cyberbullying. And cyberbullying has been there ever since. But because of internet, the bullying takes a very scary dimension. Okay, earlier bullying was verbal and physical and confined to a particular space. But now bullying can be anywhere on any media. And it's a silent bullying. The parents and the teachers are probably not even aware of it. But the worst form of bullying is revenge pornography. And revenge pornography is has caught up lately. And it's basically when a boy and a girl are friends, or the two people are friends, and they share the photos or intimate details or whatever it is, and then they break up. And then what happens? So one of them posts these photos and even goes to the extent of taking revenge by mocking them. And you can imagine the plight of a girl whose photos, intimate photos, real or unreal or mocked, are released online. So these are the issues which are so much happening on the ground currently. The other issue with the girls face a lot is cyber stalking. Stalking also has been there ever since, you know, like wo bahar majnu khada hua hai, ghar ke bahar, sidhiyan baja raha hai. But ab dekho, ab he stalks the girl. You know, I'm talking more in terms for girls today because the topic is on girls and women. And it can be on any platform. It can be multiple friends requests. It can be anything possible, a timeline. It can, and at the end of it, the frustrated Majnu can do whatever. And everything is on the internet. Internet, we have to rely that if I delete something from my timeline and I'd be happy about it, I'm an ostrich. Because actually, I have deleted what I can see. You know, it would have already been shared and posted and reposted to so many places that it will always come back to haunt me. That is why we tell another issue, digital footprint, that digital footprint is what you, when you click something, when you post something, when you like something, when you upload a photo, a video, or you send an email, anything as small as liking something leaves digital footprint online. And these footprints are not on sand, they are on concrete, and they are forever there to haunt you. And we've heard of cases when the young girls, you know, they have done whatever the young girls do during their time. Okay, they've had fun with their friends and all that. But now the parents want them to get married. Okay, so they have to have a clean slate. So fine, they delete from their timeline, but they come to us during the sessions. They ask for help when we do session for the women. That, what do I do? Can I delete the entire thing from the internet? No, you cannot. I'm sorry, you cannot. You should have thought about it when you were posting these. That's why we always tell the young ones that do not post your photos. And if you want to post, we tell them to use privacy settings and to post only to friends, to post only to small groups. But abhi kya hai? Abhi to selfie ka zamana hai. Hai ek ni, do ni, teen camera hai phones mein. And I bought a new dress. I have to flick a selfie. I have to share with my friends. Haircut, new car, everything. And I have to get so many likes. What shocked me in one of my, I was conducting a session at one place where one of the girls said, she said that, so what? When I go to the mall and I want to buy clothes, I go to the clothing store. And she said, if I'm trying on a dress, I don't buy the dress unless I have from that trial room sent a photo to my friend and my friend has approved it. She said, that's what best friends are for. Not realizing, you know, the people are posting their pictures here and there, and the fancier the phones, and you know, and then you can kind of use them, misuse them, morph them. So these are the few issues with the girls currently, which I have shared. There are many, many more, but probably they're not in the ambit of the current conversation.
Yeah, this has been very insightful, ma'am, Nisha. In fact, a lot of things, a lot of tips people have got that they have to be very, very careful before posting anything in public domain. Public domain is which everybody can see across the world.
Yeah.
And now just we move to physical domain now from the cyber to Rohit. Basically, like off late, we have been seeing a lot of cases during this lockdown period that people are forced to stay indoor. There's not able to give space to each other. And probably it has led to some cases of domestic violence. So have you or your team seen an increase in safety issues for women or housewives? And how has this arena changed? Rohit.
So, not just my team, the entire nation knows that the domestic violence has actually increased multifold. I think it has, if you talk about things statistically, in India, for every one case that gets reported, four goes unreported. I think that is the same when it comes to domestic violence now. Things have become worse now is basically because, when we talk of a time before the lockdown, even before the lockdown, the woman actually had the power in her hand to actually report the crime. Maybe she could make a phone call, or maybe she could have run to her neighbor, or she could have run to her parents to get away from the domestic violence. What does the woman do now? She is confined within those four walls. So now she can't even make a phone call. And even if she makes a phone call to the police right now is so overstretched and overworked, they domestic violence is probably the last thing on their mind. Even before the lockdown, police does not actually, in our country, does not respond too well to domestic violence. You know, it's always taken ki either pati patni ka mamla hai, either gharelu mamla hai. Isme hum kya karenge? So now when the woman is actually facing domestic violence, there is actually nobody there to help her. So, yes, the answer is the domestic violence has gone up. The child abuse has gone up. The number of men watching pornography has gone up. The pedophiles are having a field day. Basically, because this is the time when all the children are also confined within the walls. And at this point of time, at juncture, I'd like to bring out that the child is the most unsafe within the security of the house. Because the people who are around the child, you know, the uncles and the cousins and the relatives and the neighbors are the biggest predators. The threat to the child from the outside world is just probably 5 to 10%. So the threat, if the threat is inside from within the house and the child is confined within this house for the last 40 days, 60 days, or for God knows how many more days now, this lockdown will continue. So these are the men who are actually looking at these children as future investments for blackmail, for using them sexually, abuse them. Now the child might not even understand what's happening to the child. And this is not just the case for women. This is for girls. This is for young boys as well. Young boys are just as vulnerable. So yes, the cases have gone up. And the last time when I did a webinar like this, we got about 14 calls within the next 1 hour where people wanted us to help them out because they knew that calling up the police was not really helping them out.
That's too great.
Thank you, General Soy. So, what do you think is the immediate solution, Colonel Mishra? Specifically for domestic violence cases, we have definitely seen a rise. What do you think a person or a victim of domestic violence could do from an action perspective in this particular scenario? We are in a lockdown. We are stuck in those four within those four walls. How do we kind of move ahead?
See, there is one thing which I always say, but I probably say that because I come from a certain background, so it's easy for me to say. I always say, tell women to fight back. But then I guess it'll be easier said than done, right? So here is the time when the society needs to come into action. And I've been fighting this case against the RWAs. You know, I've been trying to tell these RWAs, the Resident Welfare Associations. I keep telling them, if you will not allow a COVID-19 positive patient to come into your society, and these days, I believe even the doctors are not being allowed to come in the society, you know, if they've been treating these patients.
Yeah, yeah.
How is it that you are allowing domestic violence to take place? Don't they hear the screams? Don't they hear the shouts? Don't they hear the children cry? So this is what it is. See, you see how our society works. As long as this thing is not affecting my house, it's totally okay by me. You know, and the domestic violence, you know, the woman getting beaten probably in the next house, again, the same Indian mentality. Ye unke ghar ka mamla, why should I interfere? Now, if we stop blaming the society in its entirety, and if we say ki, there is a good Samaritan who is actually walking up to the house and he rings a bell and he says, ki, yahan se bahut chillane ki awaaze aa rahi hai. You know what is the first thing the woman is going to do? The woman is going, even if she's battered, she's got a black or blue eye, she's going to say nothing. I just fell down, and she makes some, excuse, which everybody knows is an excuse, and you have to accept it. The women, so that is the place when a person is coming to help a woman out, she has to speak up. Women or children have to learn to speak up pre-lockdown, post-lockdown, any lockdown. Till such time that women actually learn to speak up, children learn to speak up, and the first, the self-defense probably, or the physical aspect of the defense comes much later. The first, of course, is your own mental strength. You have to have a resolve. Yes, you want to better your situation. Yeah. And to better your situation, the first line of defense is you yourself. You have to fight first. You have to speak up first.
Absolutely.
So yes, there is only two things that can be done. When the individual is herself standing up for herself to for the fight, and the society then helps her.
Yeah, I think you very importantly brought out two aspects of it. One is your own strength, right? Mental strength in terms of being able to accept and say it in front of others that, yes, there is an issue within my house, in my domestic household, and I am a victim of it. And the second is, right now, all the more important for your neighbors or people around you to come together to protect you in a situation like this. Like, why do you let a person like that continue living within your society when you're not allowing doctors and maybe even COVID patients, you're assaulting them? So, absolutely. The second question that I would have for you is from the, you spoke about child pornography has gone up, right? So, how do you think that would spill over post-lockdown? Like, what happens post-lockdown, and how do you think parents could engage to make sure that kids are not being preyed upon after the lockdown lifts?
That is the question for me or for Nisha?
For
Nisha, raise her hand.
Ms. Nisha, sure.
Okay, before answering the question, allow me to share the global report of National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. Okay, so they have released a global report, and as India tops amongst the list of countries which are actually consuming the porn. In India, there have been 20 lakh cases of 20 lakh reports, and then how many would have gone unreported, we don't know about that. And what we are concerned about, this report is of before the lockdown, and I mean, it would certainly accelerate, the lockdown would certainly accelerate it further. And in response to that, the audience should know, CBI has set up an online sexual abuse and exploitation investigative agency, which has been set up recently, and which will probe such offenses under the IPC. So it's not that government is taking a cognizance, government is acting upon this, but then it's the citizens also who have to be responsible, and parents have to be totally, totally alert to their child's online activities.
Absolutely. So that actually brings me to the next question. How do you think parents could engage in terms of restrictions, right? Do you think they could restrict the consumption of social media, or the kind of sites that the kids are visiting, and so on and so forth?
Am I to answer it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, as far as the parents are concerned, the parents have to understand that kids of today are very, very smart, and they are very informed, and definitely very tech savvy. And they need to treat these children like young thinking minds, and talk to them rather than talk down at them. And because children know a lot about technology than their parents know. So the parents need to instill confidence and not fear. And they need to empower, they need to educate and not penalize and punish, because that's how it will go. Now, rewinding it from when a child has has an issue to before. Okay, you give your child a connected device. While you're giving the device to the child, you have to sit down with the child and explain to the child the do's and don'ts, how to be a netizen, how to be a safe and responsible citizen. Don't we tell the kids, you know, when they go out, that they should cross the road carefully, look left, look right, and not, dangerously cross the road, or when they're driving, they're driving test, and there are so many do's and don'ts. So why not have those when your child gets the first connected device? And very important is, create an open and trusting communication with the children and tell the child, okay, there are dangers lurking in the online space. You may come across X, Y, Z, but if you do, unfortunately, if you do, I'm right behind. We are totally going to be supporting you. I don't want to dwell too much on the case of a boy, the class 12 boy who committed suicide a couple of days back. A very, very sad story. A bright young life cut short. We don't want the children getting scared, not coming to the parents and getting scared and harming themselves. Yes, definitely monitoring helps. And monitoring of small children's phones helps. And you should know which sites your child has gone to. And you should have an open conversation and with the child, you know, if you find, there is some difference in the attitudes, in the behavior of the child. And look at the child with a sharp eye. Is the child avoiding me? Is the child cooped up in the room? Or is he or she not eating properly, not communicating, not wanting to go to school, making excuses every morning? And all those things, you know, then something is wrong. Talk to the child and listen to the child. When the child talks, listen empathetically. Listen in a non-judgmental way. Listen in a non-reactive way. Let the child share what he or she is going through. Get to the root of the problem and then report it to school or report it to authorities and help the child. And at the same time, let the child know, good or bad, he or she may have done a blunder, but fine, we are totally there with you. We could also talk of certain sites and the parental controls a little later, which especially are useful for younger children.
There's another thing I'd like to add to what Nisha has already said, Sakshi. You know, it's an analogy that I was just trying to draw. You know, we're living in the times of coronavirus, right? And just today morning, there's this thing that's come in the newspaper that in spite of, you know, of all the best efforts of the government, you know, the lockdown, of course, has been successful and everything, but still the cases are rising up. And now the Ministry of Health is also telling us to now start thinking of living with the virus. You know, so you have to accept the fact that the virus is around and you have to live with it. This is exactly what the parents need to think. See, the times have changed. There was no internet during my time, right? Probably there was no dating during my time, and not so much, right? And not so open, but times are changing. Today, if I talk in terms of my own daughter, I have to accept the fact that she is of a certain age. She will have a boyfriend. She will have access to internet. Why can't I utilize this lockdown period to try to understand my children rather than just crib about the lockdown or just make memes about the lockdown, right? This isn't this the holiday that we had all been thinking about? You know, the family time, and now when God's given you the family time, you know, you're sitting and cribbing about it. So you'll never really be happy in what you do or what you do not do. So probably the parents should actually take this time to understand if the girl is of a certain age, you know, 10, 12, 13, kids are really picking it up early, right? And this is not just an urban phenomenon. The parents need to sit down with the children, talk it out, you know, and tell them, okay, this is what it is. Talk about a host of issues which probably even our teachers in school do not talk about. Remember, the reproduction chapter is always a chapter where the biology teacher always goes on chutti or misses out. Why? Because, you know, we are so shy to talk about it, right? But the fact is, you have to talk about this. And this is where what I said earlier, speaking up comes in. You open up to your child, the child will open up to you. The child is, enclosed right now because the child thinks that you are a certain generation. You know, that's exactly what I thought of about my father, that he was a certain generation. And my son is going to think about me that I'm a certain generation. And then probably, so the chain keeps going on.
Yeah.
Right? So what actually needs to be done is you have to try to understand that generation. And the moment your daughter or your son can understand that, you know, your father or your mother understands your generation, will not be your generation, of course, but can understand you, they'll open up to you.
If I may add here that, you know, taking on from what Rohit was saying so rightly, actually, this is a time when the digital migrants, that is our generation people who were not born with technology, have to bridge the gap and understand the thought process of digital natives. The kids have been born with technology. For them, it's not an add-on. Okay, that's a part of their lives. And for us, it is not. So we actually think very differently. Parents don't mean harm, but actually as parents, one, there is a generation gap. And secondly, there is an understanding of the usage of technology gap. So that needs to be bridged.
Absolutely. I think communication is the key to the whole thing. Basically, we need to have the communication with the children. We need to have, even if they have gone into some problem, if you have been able to identify what Nisha brought out, we should not be judgmental. We should not be reactive. We must listen to them. We must understand their issues and mentor them, guide them. This is the right time. We have enough time sitting at home. At times, like what was happening earlier, was there was hardly any time with the parents to spend time with the kids. They were so busy working. This is an ideal opportunity to maintain and again connect with the children. And I think, Rohit, I'll just ask you one thing. Having seen so many things, when we talk of women's safety, there are many issues, many pieces that need to be worked together to reduce crime against women. And like awareness, sensitizing them, build up mental and physical strength, which you mentioned, and also deal with the pressure of society. Because at times that also plays a big way in a parent's major mind part, and a child's mind. So how does the Mission Fight Back help this cause?
So Mission Fight Back, the first thing to do away with the fallacy, Mission Fight Back is not just a self-defense program. Mission Fight Back is one of the most holistic program in the world because we are looking at an age-old problem in a very holistic manner. What we've done is we've actually just turned the wheel. Right. What we understand is self-defense, of course, comes at a much later stage. And what what I said in the previous reply to your question, what Mission Fight Back basically does is we teach women and children to stand up for themselves. We give them confidence to stand up for themselves. The moment they have that confidence that they can stand up, so the first thing that we take out from their mind is body shaming issues. You know, because they think that they are a certain shape, a certain size, a certain strength, and probably they'll not be able to stand up, they'll not be able to fight, they'll probably look clumsy, or probably they'll not have a voice. So the first thing that we do is we give them a voice. And why is voice necessary? If the threat is coming from within the confines of the secure house, the solution also has to come from within. The solution cannot be an external thing coming from outside. The solution, if the attack is from within, the defense has to be from within. So that is the reason why the first thing that we do is we teach children to be confident enough to speak up or stand up. That is exactly what we do with the women. Once they're confident about themselves, once they're confident about their voices, then comes their body. They should be confident about their body. Then the third thing, of course, is self-respect. Any person having a certain self-respect or self-esteem will never let physical violence touch her. You know, it's like I slap somebody. Yeah. One needs to understand it's all about the power I have over the person. Why does a man hit a woman? Or why does a man hit a child? Because they know that there is going to be no retaliation coming back. It is the power they have. I bet somebody to come and do the same gentleman to actually come and have a fight with me, he'll probably think about 20 times before even he thinks of that. Why? Yeah. Because he knows that there is going to be certain retaliation. But the child or the children or the women, they're easy prey. They know, okay, he slaps a one, it's not going to get retaliated. So it gets that animal instinct out of him. And thereafter, it becomes a habit. The worst problem is not the man's habit to hit the woman. it is the habit that the woman is going to inculcate that she is going to get beaten up. So that becomes a habit within her. And that is the time when she stops speaking about it. A child getting beaten. We say that in Hindi, right? Ki pakka ho gaya, wo pit pit ke. Wo pakka isle ho gaya because he's just become impervious to the whole thing. You know, for him, it doesn't really carry any certain meaning. He knows ki, okay, this is something which has become mechanical. My father will come probably after a drink or two, or probably whenever my father gets angry, he's going to hit me. So it's become something mechanical for him. He's not even thinking about it. And that is the time when they start, when the psychological issues start building up in the woman or the child. And that is the reason why the suicides and everything starts taking place. So yes, what Mission Fightback basically does is we get into the psychological aspect of each and every child or woman, try to get them out of it. And then comes the physicality wherein we train them for self-defense. Does not mean that we are training them to fight back in the sense like hit back. But what of a situation where a man is trying to hit a woman and she's just defending herself. So that is where self-defense comes in. So these are the two things that we combine together wherein there is mental toughness and the physical strength and the confidence that you can do it. So there are three things actually which Mission Fightback combines.
Actually, I liked your tagline which says walk without fear. I mean, that's a wonderful thought that, okay, they should be able to walk without fear. That's a great thought. So I believe that you are developing an app also for, to empower them on technologically. Could you tell us about that?
So what Mission Fightback does is we're working on two fields. One, what we're working on is when we're working with schools and colleges and workplaces directly, wherein, like I said, we train women on psychological issues and self-defense. Then the other aspect is that we're working with the government. So we have a certain concept which we have spoken to the government, and we are already in touch with three state governments. And of course, we had a word with the central government in case if that can be implemented. So the concept, the idea is that citizens will have to come out to help citizens. If you expect the police, which is as it is understaffed and overworked, to come out and help, they will have problems. The problem with them is, let's say there is a problem that has happened in a certain area. And the girl, so the girl belongs to a place A, but an incident has happened in place B. The biggest problem that the police faces is jurisdiction issues. The moment there are jurisdiction issues, so then the buck keeps getting passed. Kaun sa thana kaam karega, kaun sa thana kaam nahi karega. And the criminals have become very, very smart. They always carry out crimes on the borderlines. Now think of a situation where a girl gets abducted from Gurgaon, is taken via Delhi to Ghaziabad. So there are not jurisdiction issues. The three states which have been crossed. So now the fight is going to be which state police is going to fight, try to save the girl. Then the next problem that the police has is that they have a certain time limit, 24 hours. That they, even if you go and file a missing person's report, they take 24 hours to file an FIR because they always think that probably the person's gone away and they'll come back and then they do not have the manpower. Or probably even the inclination to go after that particular case. So what we have been, the Mission Fightback concept is very simple. We have developed an app, sir. Firstly, the app is going to be with every girl. Let's say we're talking in terms of, let's say, a city which has got a strength of about 20 lakh people, out of which, let's say, 50% are women, 50% are men, thinking that the sex ratio in our country is fantastic. So that'll mean about 10 lakh women. Now, out of these 10 lakh women, they'll be of different age groups. Our target audience is girls above 10 to about 35 to 40 years of age. Now, these are the girls that we, with the help of the government, we intend to train. Now, if we bring them down further, so that means out of 10 lakh women, there'll be just about 3 lakh or 4 lakh women which would be in this age bracket. In 2 years' time, we'll train all these 3 to 4 lakh women. And any girl who is above the age of 18 and who herself decides to become a volunteer with us, she becomes a volunteer. Something what the government is also trying to do as per their app called 112. They're also asking citizens to become volunteers. In our case, we are also doing the same thing, only that our volunteers are going to be trained for a specific task, unlike 112, which is very holistic and it's talking about a host of issues. We are going to be training these girls to go out and help the women. Now, what does the app do? So, in case if a girl gets into a situation and she has got our app, which has been downloaded, which is, of course, a free download from the government side. And the moment she gets into a sticky situation, she just have to call out for help in a certain pre-recorded manner. Let's say help. So, supposing she calls out for help thrice, the phone gets activated. Even if the phone is locked, it's like saying, hey, Siri. So the moment you say, hey Siri, you don't have to actually open up your phone. The Siri does the whole work for you. This is exactly what our app does. The moment this happens, it sends signal to two people, the parents, and of course to my command center. So the moment the signal comes from my command center, I get the GPS location of the girl immediately. That is number one. Plus, I also just audio and video files after a gap of every 3 seconds. So I'll get a 10-second audio and video file. So now, audio and video file means that I have access to her camera and her mic. So now maybe the girl is smart enough to actually capture the man's face on the camera. So now we even know what the man looks like. And then if the girl, since because I have access to her mic and the girl is shouting, so maybe she's shouting out the man's name. Again, working on the premise that 95% of the time the victim knows the perpetrator. So now I have the man's name. Now what we immediately do is we inform the police because we are co-opted with the state police. So we tell the police to take their particular action. But while the action is being taken, the girls who have been volunteer or even men who have been volunteer, like NCC, Home Guards, like Delhi, you have bus marshals, you know, the likes, any good Samaritan who are written volunteers who have already signed an indemnity with the government and with us. These are the people who will react to the situation. So this is like Uberizing the app. So the nearest Uber cab or the Ola cab actually reaches you the moment you need a cab. Here, this is the first responders who are the closest to the girl. Maybe the first responder is just about 100 meters away from the girl. So these are the first people who are reacting there, reaching there in real time. And like I said, they are not vigilantes, sir, and they are not there to lynch. It's not a lynching mob. One person, let's say Sakshi here is a volunteer, and Sakshi is the one who goes there. I'm sure you'll never not let Sakshi go alone, or she'll probably want to pick up her husband or some friends. So instead of nobody reaching there, now suddenly you can have 3 volunteers, 4 volunteers or first responders reaching there and getting a whole crowd. And remember, the area is only 10 meters by 10 meters or maximum 100 meters by 100 meters. So the whole idea of Mission Fightback making this app is to actually have first responders on ground who are reaching the girl to save the girl in real time. This is what we call prevention, sir.
I think this is great. And something like, I reminded me of Hindi movies where the police reaches after the action. But this first responder system is very good and very, I think, effective. But this is, I think, the way you have the whole packages, whether it is the mental, physical and technological empowerment of the woman is, I think, a great idea. And I think I finish with this thing. And Nisha, if you have anything to add, otherwise, Sakshi, you can get down with questions. Nisha, anything you want to say?
Yes, I would also like to talk about an initiative. I mean, I'm really, really impressed by what Colonel Rohit shared today and also earlier when we met. That's what drew me towards this organization. And I also support Cyber Peace Foundation. It is a not-for-trust organization working to make sure that the cyberspace is safe, secure, and peaceful. And besides policy advocacy, they do education and empowerment of the entire ecosystem. Because you see, when you educate the children, that may not be enough. You have to also talk to the parents, talk to the teachers. But what if a child is in trouble and the complaint has to go to cybercrime.gov.in and the police has to deal with it? So police also, the law enforcement officials, the police officials have also to be sensitized to this new kind of crime. So a lot of education goes on at different levels, all those who are connected with the safety of the children. So I want to draw your attention to E-Raksha Awards, which we are going to announce soon. And instead of, you know, lecturing the students about being safe, and because they've had a lot of it and they are bored now, you know, so this is a contest for the difference where we tell the students that what is your understanding of online safety? How would you like to help somebody who's in trouble? How would you, what's your concept of a netizen, a digital citizen? And, you know, we throw a lot of questions to them and they can respond with their answers with a poster, sharing a rap about online safety video or sharing some kind of slogans or building an AI, artificial intelligence program on how to actually capture cyberbullying happening in the campus. So this competition is going to be launched next week in collaboration with the NCRT and NCPCR. And this is how we want to spread the awareness, and we want ownership from the children themselves. We don't want children to feel that every time we are talking about don'ts and the no's and the negative thing. We want children to be volunteers and children to be ambassadors, right, and children to talk about cybersecurity.
I think this is wonderful. And I think in this competition, we'll get some out-of-box solution and something different, yeah, which will come out. Otherwise, what we keep thinking, like our generation and next generation, we'll get some good ideas and new ideas. Sakshi, anything?
Sure. We're getting a lot of comments from the audience appreciating the idea of, you know, integrating technology in both cases, whether it's protecting yourself in the physical environment or protecting yourself in the cyberspace. Right. So kudos. I think people do want to know how they can download the app or when the launch would happen. When can they expect these, you know, technologies in their hands to use?
Okay, Sakshi, so we are ready with the app. We are ready to go, to that mode in at any point of time now. But since we are already talking to the government, because people need to understand this app actually has its essence in the fact that the entire citizenry can be combined together. So that is the reason at the moment, we are in talks with the government, so which probably we should have already gotten talk with the government, at least one state government at this point of time, but because of the lockdown. So probably another 6 months time, we'll be ready to roll. And in case, because of some reason, we are unable to, if the government and us, the talks or something fails, then yes, we're going to go commercial with it. Or rather, we're going to go public with it any point of time. We are ready at our end.
Excellent. Okay. Just another question that we have from someone who's viewing our discussion today. On what precautions should these volunteers take in case the perpetrator is armed? You know, if they are at a position where they could harm even the volunteers.
Okay. So that is the reason why I said that our volunteers are going to be trained first. And when I talk about training, I'm not talking about any special martial art like karate, kung fu. What we teach them is something known as FIST. That is street survival training, fast, intensive street survival training. So all these volunteers would be trained by my team to tackle any situation. That could be any situation. That could be including weapons. Okay. We will never want our volunteers to get into a situation where they actually have to face a knife. See, one must understand, we, like I said before, we are not sending vigilantes there. We are not asking one girl to go and take, her own parents are not going to allow it. Even if she's a volunteer, they're just going to switch off the phone and they say, we never really heard of it. The whole idea is to gather a crowd rather than one person going and, getting into a combat situation. The idea is that a crowd gathers up. One person, two people, 15. See, because of the app, we know the girl's name. What if there are just three women there just shouting that girl's name in that locality? We also know the perpetrator's name. What if doorbells are being rung? You see, the perpetrator is also just under so much duress because he knows that he is going to be committing a crime. So in case if nothing else, in case if voices can be heard, that itself is going to be a big thing. I reiterate, we are not expecting these volunteers to be vigilantes. But yes, in case if they can actually corner a person, right? Something like what the quick reaction team does. The idea is to localize the perpetrator and wait for the specialist like the police or somebody to come up. At least you're not letting him escape. Yeah. Maybe because of all the shouting and all the ringing of doorbells or whatever, improvisation. At least the perpetrator is not carrying out an act. Because one of the things that that a trend which has now started is, unfortunately, rape the woman, kill her. And this year, if you see the NCRB, the National Crime Record Bureau data, rather than giving out the number of rapes in our country, what they have done is statewide, they've given out the number of girls who have got raped and then killed. And you must see that data. It's eye-opening.
Very interesting. So when we talk about, facing or even just diverting or localizing a perpetrator, And the kind of training that you're providing, I believe it's a 4-stage process, right?
Yes.
So are you collaborating with experts who train in these aspects, and what kind of system are you following? What is the stage-wise stage progression process that you're following?
So when we train the schools, we have 4 levels of training. That's level 1 to 4. Each training is about 14 days each, but then again, it depends on the uptake level of the girl child or the woman. In stage 1, we of course train them to, like I said, to be confident about their bodies, to understand that they can fight in any dress, at any point of time, in any given situation. And in stage 1, they are learning to fight one person at a time. Stage 2 is a time when these women or these girls, they actually learn to fight with weapons or to ward off weapons. By the time it is stage 3, and stage 4, they're actually improvising, and they're also learning to fight multiple attackers. So by the end of all these 4 stages, what is actually happening is, like I said, it's a holistic training. And what we advocate is, we do not want girls to come and train with us in yoga pants or jeans or any kind of comfortable clothing. You know, because when the situation happens, most likely the woman might be wearing... probably a sari, right? Or maybe the girl is actually in a certain dress, because if she's gone to a pub or she's gone to a concert, maybe she's wearing those high heels, what do you call, stilettos?
Yeah.
So something like that. We'll train you to fight wearing those stilettos.
Much required, I have to say.
So I think something like street fighting. You hit with anything you get hold of and just...
Yes, sir. It's street fight, sir.
Okay.
Very interesting. Nisha, we have one question for you from the audience on how do you build that support system? So you spoke about, you know, how a lot of personal pictures sometimes go around, the cyber crimes that are occurring, and how parents should respond to it. It should be more of a support system, but how do you build it? Because I think that's one of the biggest challenges people face. There are very few households, if we take percentage wise, where you'll get that support saying, hey, it's not your fault and we're going to face this together. How do we sensitize the parents, the community, our siblings around this aspect?
Okay, first we need to sensitize the people about privacy and not sharing personal details. So if the young people are sensitized about that, then half of the problems are as it is solved. And yes, you're right, there are a lot of households, because internet is a new phenomenon. And in the tier 3, tier 4 cities, we have first generation learners. So how can we have second generation internet users? Okay, so that is why when civil society organizations and all, we all conduct the programs, we make sure that this entire ecosystem is getting sensitized to it, whether it is the school teachers or the counselors or the parents. And in the smaller cities, we bank a lot on volunteers, because, you know, we cannot be everywhere. So the CyberPeace has volunteers who are actually totally trained on the entire practices and on the entire advisories and all that. And they are a feet on the ground and they share ahead. And the states are taking a lot of interest in getting their police people trained. Okay, the constables on the ground, the people who are in the in various organizations placed wherever, thanes or wherever, because the readdressal of the crime comes to them, and cybercrime cannot be treated like an ordinary crime, like with a danda this day. You have to be very sensitive. You know, if there is a girl whose pictures have been morphed and put up, she cannot be questioned the same way any other criminal would be questioned. So states are doing a lot of initiatives. In fact, in the month of March, we had organized programs with NCRB, National Crime Records Bureau. And it was again a contest. It was again a contest where the states has had to share innovative initiatives taken to solve cybercrime. And I must tell you, I was totally amazed. I didn't know that the police people at that level had such a high understanding of technology. and were using these technical equipment and all that devices so well for tracking crimes. So yes, the whole ecosystem has to be actually empowered for us to get the right data.
Absolutely.
That's true.
Sakshi, there is a question which I just read from one of the audience, one Mr. Bodhi Dharbun.
Yes.
Sir, if I'm reading a question right, you're asking that you have a 2-decade martial art training and yet it gives you shivers. I totally agree with you. And how are we training women and children to manage when the encounter suddenly happens? Very rightly brought out, what he's saying is absolutely right and I totally agree with him. But what he needs to understand is there is a whole lot of difference between martial arts and what I teach, right? Everybody's heard of, sports like Krav Maga. Art like Krav Maga or Kali. These are not sports. These are basically art which have been picked up from different art. And these are street survivals. When we talk in terms of karate, kung fu, please remember these are sports now. They're categorized under sports. And General Soi and me, we are from the same regiment. And, we've trained with our troops, which are the fiercest of troops. But, even the best of soldiers, irrespective of the training that he's had in the regimental center, you really do not know how is he going to react to a situation when a live bullet is fired on his head. So this is something that we faced actually on ground. Even the best soldiers, they actually shiver and they freeze. Whereas probably the most indisciplined soldier is the one who's running right ahead and is the one who's getting you all the results and the kills. This is exactly the reason why Mission Fight Back, actually, rather than just becoming a self-defense organization, actually, like I said, our task actually starts in mental training, the psychological aspect of it. And as far as Mr. Bodhi is concerned, I just hope, I can only hope that I have, and I believe he's a Kali practitioner. So if he's a Kali practitioner, he will know that what does Kali do actually? It is basically, you are not firstly using your own strength, you're using the strength of an opponent. Where in karate and kung fu, where it is, have you ever seen a person on street do a karate or a taekwondo? In a close combat, you are very close to your perpetrator. You're never going to maintain an air gap wherein you can, probably take 3 steps back and then take a 360-degree kick and then do it. That only happens in movies, right? So that is the reason why, Mr. Bodhi, it is very important. And that is the reason why what we do is we get the psychological aspect out of the girl. What if I'm training a girl, but she's suffering from anxiety or depression? I can keep training her for the next 20 years and I'll not be able to get the result. But within 14 days, we get her out of the problem that she's facing mentally. And then you should see, and a case in point here, had the lockdown not happened, I was supposed to be in Nainital. The girl that we've trained, one of the girls that we've trained in one of the boarding schools in Nainital, an 8th standard girl, she actually ended up bashing 3 boys, or 3 men rather, who are tourists who had come to Nainital, who were bothering her friend. And that is the same evening when I got a call from the principal saying, Colonel, this is what one of your girls have done. And that is the day when I said, I feel like a proud father because my daughter has actually gone and out there and achieved something. So yes, in case if you set your mind to it, probably 5 years or 10 years of martial art is not going to help. It is basically your body movements. In case if you know that somebody is going to hit you and the first thing that happens is your hand comes up. So it gets inculcated in your body and you learn to defend yourself. I just hope I've answered that for you.
Yeah, just wanted to add to this is, like in girls, they should be, like what when you teach, or maybe we talk of mental strength, and there should be situational awareness should be there. Okay, this is an area where something can happen and she's mentally already prepared and she doesn't freeze when she reacts. The worst danger could be when out of fear, out of this anything, shock, they freeze and then they are not able to react. The moment this kind of mental strength is there, then they are situationally aware and they know in their mind, if something happens, then I will react in this manner. That's how I think very important to build up this kind of thing. Yes, Sakshi.
Yeah. Actually, the question that you read was definitely the last of the questions that we have from the audience. But we do have a lot of concerns people have shared around domestic violence, the increase, and the fact that not every time people around you will come to support or help you out of a situation. But yes, you've taken those during the discussion itself. Anything else that you would want to add as closing remarks, Colonel Mishra?
Fight back.
Fight back.
Yeah.
Fight back. Fight back. Fight back.
Nisha.
Nisha.
Okay. The message to the young ones is that don't lay out your life on the internet. Don't make your life public. That's very dangerous. And yes, your parents may be from a different generation, but they will definitely take a step ahead, but you should also. And that's where the happiness and safety lies. And stay safe and maintain social distance.
Stay safe.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Nisha. Thank you so much, Colonel Mishra. It's been a pleasure to have you both. And thank you, everyone, for joining us today. I hope you all gained something out of the discussion and see you again soon next week.
Thank you, Sakshi. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Nisha.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Stay home.
Bye-bye. Stay safe. Yeah, thank you.